Wailuku, Hilo, and Kohala on the island of Oahu, Maui, and Moku'o Keawe. The Aluli Ohana is a large and diverse group of scholar activists who have spent their lives in Hawaiian education, justice, land reclamation, law, health, cultural revitalization, arts education, prison reform, transformational economics, food sovereignty, Hawaiian philosophy, and most of all, music. Manu works in the field of indigenous epistemology and its role in worldwide awakening. Professor Aluli Meyer obtained her doctorate from Harvard. Okay. Oh, I'm so proud that you're here. I wanted to make sure. You can read it online. She's everywhere. Thank you.
Lala Nuss, everybody. My manager. Aloha kaulana e inoha no. Wahine ui. Aloha mai kakoa pau. Welcome to this panel. It's gonna be fun. Are we having fun? Okay, because this crowd is, you guys, you get the gem. Because this discussion is going to be about the elephant in the room. Okay, I don't care what it says in social media. I don't read social media. But we're discussing with these indigenous curators that are very beloved. They're going to share with you some ideas about their own, what they want to share about curating as indigenous women. All right, so let's go through who's here. Number one, Tanya Harnett, Nakota Sioux, First Nations Canada. Welcome, Tanya. She teaches at the University of Alberta. And they might have a story to share about that darn feather. Then we have Noelle Kahanu from the University of Hawaii at Manoa, via the Bishop Museum, via Washington, via all sorts of life-changing experiences in all those places. Welcome, both of you. And then there's Ngahiraka Meritu Ahi Mason, the co-curator here for the Honolulu Biennial, my beloved partner. And a curator extraordinaire in Aotearoa, New Zealand, for the last 20 years. These women have experience. So the question tonight is, and please, have fun with it, because tension really allows for deep, deep truths. We want to push forward an energetic field of art and creativity and the acknowledgement of indigenous clarity in this field, okay? So the question is, describe your elephant in the room in relationship to art and curate indigeneity in art.
So I, you know, there's things where you're multiple things. You know, you're multiple people, you wear multiple hats, and I don't feel like I'm any one thing at any one point in time, and time is moving on and it unfolds. So what I think I'm going to do, first of all, is start out with some of the words from my great-grandfather. Dan Kennedy, or Ochangaka. First of all, this is, I've been here for 48 hours. And this is a problem. This is a problem just coming up here and taking the mic and not knowing much about the place. Because I think what we need to do is stop and think about how we relate to each other. And it takes time. It doesn't just take, you know, drop in on an airplane in 48 hours and here you go and, you know, talk about the place you're in. I'm just learning and very much learning about ceremonies here. And I want to thank for the opening ceremonies. It's very important that you know, you get to experience these things in another country. So in my territory, I come from a long-standing history. So I'm going to talk about my great-grandfather's first, because I think his words will help push this discussion further. He lived from 1876 to 1976. So he was a centenarian. In 1884, one of the largest residential schools was built in the prairies. And he went there in 1886. So in my family, we've seen three generations of residential schools. And I would be something that would be called intergenerational. So I feel the weight of my family. So it doesn't really happen very often that you can get stories. Grandpa Kennedy's name is Ochangaga, which means pathfinder. And sometimes I feel, because I continue these stories, I feel like I carry that path maker tone. Okay, so I'm going to just go right to the story. When the white men were to come, in the pre-reservation days, after the morning chores of driving the ponies to the water and changing the hobble lines, the men usually congregated in little groups outside the camp to smoke and to fraternize. We youngsters were playing tag nearby when somebody called me, and I stood still and hesitated to approach my elders until my grandfather, Panapin, called me by name. I stood before them. One of the elders pointed to a tattoo I had on my left cheek beneath the eye and said to my grandfather, "Panabin, mark that tattoo on your grandson's cheek. You're fortunate indeed to have that mark of identification on your grandson's face." One of the redcoats at Fort Walsh told me, when the western migration of the white men begins in earnest, they'll come in swarms, like grasshoppers in flight. They'll occupy our buffalo country and will build centers like anthills. When these things come to pass, Okisha, the redcoats, told me that we would not be able to identify our own people. Furthermore, he continued, our children and our grandchildren will be taught the magic art of writing. Just think for a moment what that means. Without the aid of a spoken word, our children will transmit their thoughts on a piece of paper, and that talking may be carried to distant parts of the country and convey your thoughts with friends. Why, even the medicine men of our tribe can't perform such miracles. I stood spellbound and listened to the awe of this wonderful revelation and tried with my childish mind to grasp its significance. Was this dream a prophecy or what? Whatever it was, the dream is fathered a fact. I remember his funeral. I was 5 years old. He was alive to see the buffalo slaughtered and annihilated. The fact that I breathed the same air, I carry that story, the story of the buffalo, and I feel the responsibility to carry this forward. But if we're thinking that words have only, we're just starting to be able to share words amongst Indigenous folks, now we're actually sharing spaces, we're sharing ivory tower, we're in the white cube. how can we just jump in to a place and not feel that ground, not know what's going on? The tribe next to ours, tribal enemies, the Blackfoot, I spent 10 years there teaching before I even got to know the people. It took 10 years for me to be accepted in that community. How can I just come here and not experience that time? So in my mind, I'm really bothered by that idea that what's happening amongst us as art curators and writers, we're just being presumptuous and we're not taking time, and we need to go back and think about the time and listen, deep listening.
We have many different ways of discussing this and practicing the difference between listening and hearing, and that idea is found in our own language, ho'olohe ho'ololu. And Lono is our deity of our orifices, the deity of abundance, the deity of harvest, the deity of peace. So the distinction is a very good one. And we don't expect you to understand this place. We honor you by asking you for your own ideas. So please understand that many, many things about Indigenous cultures are actually inferred. We never actually talk about it. The inference is called tacit knowledge. That tacit knowledge is actually the driving i'ini, the activating principle. So I recognize and honor, and we are actually getting to know you through this process, and therefore getting to know your grandfather. Because we here in Hawaii, we actually are, we're at the cutting edge of our own listening. So I appreciate that that response. Because when Ngahiraka asked me to moderate this panel, most people aren't even aware that Indigenous curators are actually a vibrant movement on the planet. Indigenous knowledge systems are actually very, very central to movements in the world, because indigeneity is a synonym for continuity. Continuity includes everybody, but in the politics of indigeneity, Hawaiians are the indigenous root here. I'd like us to learn that we are the root, not the host. Hosting infers we have a choice. We are the root, and we're not sassy about it, but we have to be clear. And I want to invite Noelle Kahanu, who practices that root understanding, to actually really go into what you feel about art and art production in Hawaii during this time, and be absolutely pono and present with that, please. E olu olu mai oi.
So the reality is that I feel like, I guess my concern is that the Native Hawaiian art movement has been co-opted. And I say that not in response to this exhibit, but I say this in response to a decade of more of having Maui Arts Month that turned into then movement. And yet, I don't see the broad impact of that movement in our community. I see a relatively small handful of arts organizations that are receiving the vast majority of the funding out there. And then I see a few scrappy groups who are doing amazing work with almost nothing. And I think we're such a small community here in Hawaii that it's really difficult to have that conversation. It's really difficult to read, because sometimes I'm a grant reader, to read or to see who's getting the grants and where the money is going. And I'm talking about just our own Hawaiian arts community. So I don't know what this looks like. I don't know what the answer is. What I will say is that this process of the biennial, there were some really hard conversations when they first came. I mean, people were suspicious, myself included. I mean, every time you see a biennial or a triennial and it says Asia Pacific, it's usually the capital A and a small p. So I think it's a miracle. I think it is fabulous that they have been able to accomplish this biennial in a way that is different from every other one that exists out there. And I think it has to do with the fact that there was pushback, that there were some like hard conversations that were had with the founders. And then in the end, they brought on Ngahiraka, and she had that ability to mediate and also to not always pose things as if the opposition was coming externally, but that there were these difficult, challenging ideas and curatorial choices that had to be made, and that only could have been made with someone of her caliber and experience to really push them in that direction. So I'll just end it there, but I think that we have so much potential and we're not where we need to be. And I don't know what that means when Imai Kalani Kalehele and Rocky Jensen are kind of like they're external so often to our process. So what are we even doing in terms of celebrating the visionaries who came before us? I think we're doing a really good job of taking care of some of our younger artists, but we have to do as much or more for those who have led the way.
Mahalo for that. Because, you know, in a continuity kind of way, you do take care of your elders, you know, but in a Hawaiian way, you feed the kids first. You know what I mean? That's a Hawaii Lona to me, because of the nature of every culture does it differently. And we have an ololo no eau, a ohe pau ka ike ka hala o ho'okahi. Not all knowledge is found in one school. So the absolute respect for diversity is at the core of what Hawaii is. And absolutely, you are correct. Ngahiraka has been pivotal in creating what you see today, and absolutely pivotal. And so I want to, because that was a heavy thing to hear, that Hawaiian art has been co-opted. So I want to go into that a little later, and but I wanted to ask you, Ngahiraka, about your elephant in the room that you wish to talk about in relationship to being Indigenous and a curator.
Mahalo, Manu, and this is a pleasure actually to sit on the stage with these two amazing women. And friendships are amazing things. And I've come to all my projects through friendships. I actually came to curating through friendships. I never intended, I didn't train to be a curator. I trained as a fine artist, and I happened to be in a certain place in a certain time, and this is how I entered the field of curation. So that's not my elephant in the room, but my elephant in the room does have something to do with what both Tanya and Noelle are talking about. And I think the co-opting, if I can just jump in there, is the co-opting of indigeneity. I don't think it's unique to Hawaii. This is something I've written about and talked about in Aotearoa. In fact, I had to leave Aotearoa with over 20 years experience in a public art museum to be able to say what I thought and work how I want. As a professional, and also as a curator with some ideas that don't quite fit the white cube, And so you can imagine not a lot of projects get made because there are so many other priorities that the institution has and that the culture at large has. So that was my own coming to myself as an individual and a person that was that is indigenous to Aotearoa, to actually confront that. So my elephant in the room is twofold. It's my personal becoming, actually just accepting what role I inhabited. And I always refer to my role as Indigenous curator as a J-O-B. It didn't mean that I inhabited that, but the perception was that I was that. But that's ridiculous, right? To put that on an individual that is the only Indigenous person in a very conservative, wonderful institution, but to expect that one person to carry the responsibility of Indigenous and of Māori. So that was my coming to understanding that I did that to myself for 20 years. Don't get me wrong, I had a great time. And I met some wonderful people along the way, and and part of that are the friendships that have developed with both these women during my tenure at Auckland Art Gallery. But I guess my real elephant in the room pertaining to Indigenous artists, and I use that word very particularly because not all Indigenous persons identify as Indigenous. So you work with what you work with. And then I thought to myself, well, what's my problem around this? I inhabited willingly this idea of an Indigenous curator. I'm still not certain that that is actually what we do. I didn't only work with Indigenous people, I had to work with a collection that was from the 14th century to the present day. So, was that really appropriate? So, in my realization of my own, reflections of what I had been doing for 20 years, and then I, gave myself the freedom not to be doing that longer, something amazing happened before I left Aotearoa 2 years ago, and that was I actually didn't like the trajectory, the pathways that had been opened to Indigenous artists, and I really didn't like the way that those opportunities or those situations had been realised. So I was part then, I had to realize I was part of this problem of how we go out into the world and represent or interpret. And already in this exhibition, that has become a talking point about how an individual can speak for their culture. And so I started saying, before I left Aotearoa, that one can only speak for themselves and their family, and to presume under any banner that you can speak on behalf of a group of people is kind of ridiculous, right? And so that was my elephant in the room that led to many other baby elephants.
Nice. So can you talk amongst yourselves around that idea? What does that mean? Yeah.
Baby elephants.
Talk amongst yourselves.
Baby elephants. I love that term, and you make me laugh through this time we've been talking. We've only known each other for a very short period of time, and it's been fast friends and almost by happy accidents. And deep conversations. Really deep conversations about what's appropriate and what's not, how you feel trapped into what you're doing in as a curator or as a writer, as a person who's representing, and do you have the right to represent? Never mind, do you have the right to tell stories, other people's stories? I am right now still upset about somebody else telling a traditional story of mine just recently in Australia. And it's about a massacre, a family massacre, and another person. And I can barely talk about it because I'm so upset about it. We had a sacred place where we had a massacre, and when it happened, it's so gruesome that everybody in Canada and in England stopped and reconsidered what it meant, and the establishment of the Northwest Mounted Police happened as a result of this massacre. And that's 30 people, direct descendants from my tribe, and somebody else from another tribe sent a drone over this land that I would never even consider to make art of. When somebody else does it. So that's a big elephant for me. It's not a little elephant, but I do have other little elephants, but a lot.
So I actually gave a talk somewhat like this a while ago. But I was thinking about, okay, we don't have elephants in Hawaii. I mean, really, what was our largest mammal? And ironically, it was a pua'a. There's like a big pig right outside, in terms of sort of trying to go back to what is more culturally honest and reflective for us. And I would suggest that going back to kind of this idea of only speaking for yourself, and it actually goes back to what Kumuhina was saying earlier, is knowing when it's knowing our own boundaries and understanding when some things are right and not right for ourselves. So since there's Ava here to our left, I just wanted to share a story about when we had the Ku exhibition in Hawaii. In 2010, we brought that those three large images from throughout the world together. But as a woman, I had to facilitate that process and really understand when there were times where it was not appropriate for me to be or to be involved in that decision making. And they used, maybe use is not the right word, but they opened their Ahakane conference in Hawaiian Hall in front of the Ku, and no one other than the men were allowed to be in the room. And it was this amazing, beautiful ceremony, and I was like standing on the steps, right, toward Pacific Hall, kind of leaning in, and it was enough to be present and that close enough to know and to feel like the space, the ki'i, everything was being honored in just the way that it was meant to be. And if it means that I have to be removed from that space, that was acceptable. So I think that it's really sometimes checking our own expectations or desires, right? And then how do you have those conversations, especially, and I'm speaking really from an ethnographic standpoint, but it is sort of the academic violence. It is the PhD violence that so often happens, that as if that kind of knowledge is more significant or more important than cultural knowledge. And how do you advocate for, you know, I mean, for example, if you're someone who's worked in an institution for over a decade and they somehow determine that person is not eligible for being elevated, then I think that's a problem with the institution, that you did not invest time in your own people to honor them, to professional development, whatever it is, there is an obligation, an institutional obligation to raise our people up. And in the absence of that, that is a kind of violence that I think that we need to address, talk about.
Okay. I want to say something. I just want to ask a question. I want to
thank you for that, and I just want to tell the gang that when there's this type of the word for violence, by the way, we didn't have elephants, but it's a saying, okay? The saying is so we don't have flying pua either. Okay? So just as a segue to the concept of our interpretations, because this panel is about seeing what is indigenous around how we interpret how to deliver ideas. So do we do it differently? How do we do it differently? What is the process of our thinking that allows us to see it differently? And so these emotions, you know, it's my job to catch the knowledge in the center of the words like violence. Because if all we hear is violence, then we close. But the function of the word actually points to something. And that depth is the separation of respect for people. And you know, because one of the main tenets of continuity, of indigeneity, is the concept of continuity. And if you do not respect the people that you're working with and do not work to elevate them, and you bring someone outside to take a job that they should have had, then what? That is a'olepono. So, and that affected all of us. And so, and this is the nature of indigeneity. We aren't clear about what it is. It drops into a racial distinction. And when it drops into a racial distinction, the polemics just start flaring, you know. You're not Hawaiian, you know what I mean? And it's not a racial distinction. This is what I want to ask you, Ngahiraka. If indigeneity is not simply a racial distinction, what is it for you in relationship to how you see what you do? Because this is directly correlative to what you feel, see, and know. Because please talk about how you chose the things you did so that the concept of violence became, because it was pretty violent, became clarity. When violence turns to clarity, then we transform society. Do you understand the question?
I do, but I want to talk about little elephants first.
Oh, well, okay.
So
that's like being a moderator.
But it is related because all my curatorial practice has been, it's been an exercise in me understanding myself, right? So all the exhibitions I've made, including the artists that I work with, comes from a foundation of being in relationship with an individual, with a collective, and with a community. So this is how, surprise everyone, this is how I make exhibitions. And if I don't have a relationship with an individual, I feel I'm not being puno with my own personhood. And it's not fair to me to, it's not fair to the artist or the community or the group to be exposed to my own unpuno practices. So that's one platform that I like to work from. And the other is, I'm a little odd in some way in Aotearoa, because I do come from tacit knowledge. I mean, some things I just work totally intuitively. I work from my gut. Yes, sure, I'm Western trained, and you know, I have the benefit of all this understanding, but I still default to my tacit knowledge. And this is stuff that I've experienced. This is how I grew up. This is how I live. This is the real me. You're not seeing any unedited version of me. This is it. And it's not usual in the field of curation, and nor is it welcome in institutions, actually. But I didn't know that when I entered the institution. They just saw a Māori and said yes. So I broke every rule because I did not know the rules, but that was me working in tacit knowledge mode. And they did not know that's what I was doing. But to me it was perfectly clear, but it wasn't. And so, you know, I really get that Indigenous people have this, you know, really high tolerance for working in very ambiguous spaces and working in very difficult conditions. But at some point you realize, wow, this is not apples and apples at all. You know, this is something else. This is not even kumara and kumara. You know, it's really, and that when you strike that realization, it's shocking. It's shocking. And so I'm going to share this little elephant because it was shocking to me. And this happened very recently. In fact, in the Sydney Biennale, that Brett Graham was an artist, one of the artists in that exhibition. And Tanya was there, but we might have met, I'm not really sure, at that point. And I've certainly shared the story with Noelle. But there was an exchange between First Nations Aboriginal curators. There was a massive curator tour that came down from Canada. Because the following biennial, Sydney Biennale, was being co-curated by Gerald McMaster. A fellow, we'll just pull him into being responsible as well. And this whirlwind of Indigenous curators came down from Canada with artists and completely was so impressive that, you know, I had to think about what was it? Like, how did this happen? Money makes that happen, of course. But the manner in which this engagement with contemporary art, because of course that's why we were all there, but it was the lack of relationship with the Aboriginal people that shocked me. And so I was friends, I'm friends with the Aboriginal curators. And you end up being part of a very small group of people, so you gravitate to each other. And so there was several things that happened that stunned me, because I imagined that there were relationships between First Nations Canadians and Aboriginal people of Sydney. And when I realized that by behaviors that there was absolutely no relationship and no understanding. And so, I kind of, tried to take a moment over it and then just got mad about it. Because I thought, well, how can we stand on a platform of puno, of love, of care, and of connectivity, and have disregard when we come in from another place and don't know anything about the place that we're landing in and don't bother to ask. So this is, did I say that was a little elephant or a big one? Okay, it's a big elephant. It was a moment for me to pause, really, because then I saw how I had been part of that in different ways, where I could have said something about what an artist was doing in somebody else's land, but I didn't. And I could recall, then I started to recall so many of these incidents that I thought, what am I doing in this field? Elevating artists, taking art around the world.
but you know, this funny misstep occurs, and we don't talk about it. So I think that was the scariest part, is not, you know, trying to have that conversation, but the very limited willingness to engage in that. So,
Tanya, can you respond to that?
I came here for this. So the Canada Council brought a contingency of curators, and all in good intention. But this is what happens if you don't take the time. Time needs to build. It needs to build relationships. And I've talked to several of the curators before I came here, and the issues with curation that was happening, specifically with Gerald McMaster, we felt that there shouldn't have been an Aboriginal North American Indigenous person curating in Australia. That should have been somebody who was First Nation or Aboriginal in Australia. And if we didn't have the time to talk about that, because I think it was just this train that was blowing through. So as this was happening, I was to be setting up a exchange. And a lot of, since then, I think it's 5 years ago, isn't it? 5 years ago. 5 years ago, and this is still an elephant that we haven't talked about. I think this is the first time we're actually talking about this elephant. So people come, I ask if I could, I'm not with the Canada Council group. I am, they're my friends. But I was paying my own way to establish this Melbourne exchange with RMIT. What happened though was this incredible thing, and I even don't know, it was so hotly political that people wanted to, you know, it was huge. I don't even know how far I should talk about this. People brought gifts, traditional gifts from North America. They're very important, sacred gifts. Almost all of them were confiscated at the border, like it would be in Australia. Except for what I brought. I somehow made it through, but what I was carrying was the most sacred thing to Native American people. It was an eagle feather. Now, an eagle feather is so powerful that it has stopped legislation in Canada. Completely stopped. Elijah Harper has stopped legislation in Canada with a feather. So you don't question a feather. An eagle feather that I brought was giving to the person who was arranging this trip. And that eagle feather was given to somebody that was contested. I don't think it really matters. It doesn't matter who. Because what this eagle feather did was brought this conversation today. And this conversation is about taking that time and knowing that eagle feather wasn't just brought to one person. That eagle feather was brought to Australia. And I think that eagle feather was a reminder that we need to take time. We need to take time and learn a little bit more from each other.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You were saying the same thing differently.
You're saying all the same things differently, all of you. So I wanna just really honor that, because everyone's got their interpretation of that event. But the main thing is respect. Respect for relationship, respect for the quality. The mo'o lives, continuity lives in the quality of our relationships. And Ngahiraka's in a, I know that you are saying that you were in a profession that basically was dismissive of those ideas. Because I've seen it. So continuity, indigeneity, like who gets invited, who are VIPs, you know, it's really about a capitalistic economy and all that. So there's a separation between what really engenders us to care for each other. There are obstacles everywhere. And so, but the eagle feather, do you want to respond to that in how you understood it and why it's an important aspect? Because it is exactly what Noelle is talking about also.
What I saw, what the interpretation I came away with, and I have shared this with Tanya, is that in that gesture of giving a significant object was a misunderstanding. It was your understanding, was the Canadian First Nations understanding of the power and meaning behind that gesture, but it didn't have the same meaning. So we had conversations about, what are we doing? We're taking very sacred and special things from our individual cultures and places and overlaying these meanings on top of other people's cultures. So what are we doing in that process? We're sort of neo-colonizing each other with our, you know, precious sacred objects, and doing it very publicly, which is very confusing for our publics. You know, when we are also commodifying special things, and when they're not received in the way that you expect them to perform for you, because that is part of the giving, is that they are supposed to, you know, do something, they activate something, whether it's relationship, whether it's you know, some element that is in one's mind. But that journey, once you give something of that sacred, you've started a journey that the recipient of this object now is part of their history, and that is not always straightforward when we do these practices that we can pat ourselves on the back with, saying, well, this is what we would do at home. Well, actually, you're not at home. And so, you know, this is the kind of exchange that I have with Tanya. And some of it is just really amazing that we have the opportunity to really examine and reflect our role or our hand in celebrating contemporary art, yet we're also creating these other incidents that we really need to give more thought to.
Can you respond to that, Noelle, just before?
So I'm going to shift a little, but still on the same idea, but put it in the context of the recent return of Kalanio Pu'u's cloak from Te Papa, from Aotearoa, back to Hawaii after over 200 years of it being gone. But I think it goes to the point of why things leave. Why are they given away? Granted, this particular exchange happened on our own aina, but, you know, there's not too much, there's people don't spend too much time thinking about the circumstances under which it was actually gifted. And you know, there's a famous Weber where you see the three canoes and they're sailing, and the bottom says, you know, gifts given to Captain Cook or something like that. But I think that the assumption then is that the canoes actually went on board the ship and the gifting took place there. That's what the image implies. But the reality is that they came around, they circled around Cook's ship and went back to shore. And Cook understood that he was being summoned. They were chanting their way around and they went back to shore. So he got in his little boat and went over. And at that point, Kalaniopuu gifted him with the cloak and the mahiole and kahili, a feathered fly whisk, as they called it. So Kalaniopuu determined the time, place, and manner of that gift. It was not some casual thing that he did, right? And he was actually kind of at the end of his life. He had unsuccessfully tried to conquer Maui several times. He only was able to achieve, you know, a few villages. But, you know, I think that at that point in his life, he saw this man from outside, and he thought it was a man, not a god, because he actually they exchange names, he and Cook. Of course, Cook's dead 3 weeks later, but he did not reclaim that cloak. He didn't say, oh, the guy I intentionally gifted it to is no longer alive, so, you know, return that, please. So I think the point is that he knew it would leave, and he did so. He gifted it so that it would leave. And there's this word, mana, right, that most that we know of, but there's also, and this is from Pulama really talking about it, the word for hand is mana mana lima, but when they talk about the rays of the sun, it's la mana mana. So there is this notion that mana can extend and go beyond, and that projection of mana is, I think, what his intent was all along. So, and how is that different from what Hokulea does? That we travel with this knowledge that we have to share, this mana that will persist beyond our shores. So it left by an act of Pacific generosity, but it returned by an act of Pacific generosity. Because Te Papa and those in conversation, in relationship with people from Hawaii, bearing witness to all of these pilgrimages to honor Kalaniopuu as embodied in his Mea Vaivaili'i, they see fit to return them, to return him to us. Now, I think it's extraordinarily profound, and we can celebrate that return. But what Keone Nunes said when I was interviewing him for this article, and he said, gee, that was the easy part. Getting him home was the easy part. What is difficult is maintaining the responsibility that we have to him now that he's here. And the messages, the things that we learn from his journey home is now, but it's based on our behavior, right? The notion that, you know, what is contained in these gifts that come and go and the obligations and responsibilities, and I'll just end with one small little thing because I think it's so fabulous. So they have couriers, right? Official couriers that deliver artwork. So they had a courier come down to return something to Te Papa and then turn around and put the cloak on it. So this guy says, never has that happened. It's such a rare thing that they would actually, it's a courier from one point to another. You don't actually, it doesn't align where you have you have something going out exactly at the same time as something's coming in. So the cloak, they're going out, but guess what was returning? It was a portrait of Captain Cook. And so there's still that binding relationship, even centuries later, right? And so this notion of just kind of the agency of whether it's an agency in a feather or in a cloak, the notion that we may think we dictate the circumstances, but we need to acknowledge that there are other factors, other entities, other beings that circulate that help to make those outcomes happen.
Mahalo. Tanya, can you speak to that energy in relationship to the feather?
Yes. I was having this conversation with Ngahiraka in regards to what that feather was. Like, the feather did go to one person. And I think that one person was actually a carrier. I don't think that feather was about that one person. I actually, now, 5 years later, as this keeps going, and it hasn't stopped, this conversation hasn't stopped, I think it's about slowing us down. I think the feather is actually coming to Australia to remind us that we have to slow down and listen to each other. Commodification, I went like this. Yeah, because I wouldn't call it a commodity. Eagle feathers are sacred, so I wouldn't call it a commodity. That's money, and it's not about that. And whether it should have been on this territory or not, in Australia, whether it should be there or not, it is. And eagle feathers always find their way for some reason. It wasn't me that gifted the feather. The feather came with me. And why that happens, we don't question these things. And why is it brought this conversation? There's a reason for it. And I think it's about us stopping and slowing down and listening a little bit more.
Shall we listen a little more? Shall we listen?
Well, there's so many different interpretations, because it really wasn't about the feather. You know, in Hawaii, if we don't travel with about 40,000 gifts and give it out, I don't know, every second, you know, it's like, thank you, thank you, thank you. We give gifts to the cab drivers, you know what I mean? Like, you want to invite Hawaiians to places because we just, right? It's true. So the point is, what is it about each other's culture that allows for the depth of our own exchange and not just the periphery of nothing? So do we succumb to the commodification of art, or is art a transforming experience of cultural diversity? That's the discussion for me, because that is what I felt that discussion was about, and I was not there. But the point for me is that when cultures clash, the people of that place have the pono and have the responsibility. See, responsibility is the higher frequency rights is here. The responsibility is a cultural given that we're going to wānanga an idea. This is what I love about wānanga. Wānanga, of course, is a Maori word that implies, and that actually is a way of discussion. It's a very unique way of discussing. You clearly state ideas, you disagree, you listen to each other, and there's a heightened sense of understanding. Hawaiians, 1,000 years earlier, we still use the term, we say vānana, same word, different energy, but vānana for us means to prophesize. So when you're in a great discussion, you are in essence prophesizing your future. So the quality of that understanding is what I was hoping and we're heading to because of the nature of your truth shared. But I want to have each of you end this discussion with a final statement around prophecy. Vanana, wananga, you know, what is the prophecy that you want to ho'upu'upu into the world around what continuity, indigeneity, quality relationships mean for going forward, okay? We start with you, no? Start with you, go to Tanya, and then we'll finish with you, Nahira. E olu olu mai.
My goodness. Okay, so I think we prophesize in this particular space, in this particular location, right? That brings together artists from all different cultures throughout Asia and the Pacific, connected by Oceania, right? That which touches their Aina. And I think that it bears testament to so much of the pain. We're talking about cancer, we're talking about health issues for people from the Marshalls, right? We're talking about all we need is tolerance. I mean, there's so much pain, but also richness in this space. And I think we're at this moment in time where that clarity is what is gonna move us forward. It is about responding in a way that shows that actually the arts and culture is more important than ever before at a time when there's probably gonna be less funding for it, right? But we compensate for that. We rise to that occasion. That's why with particular organizations that are threatened, the funding for them, the monies have been pouring in from private sources. So I think that we need to understand, and you've said this before, and I really take it to heart, that this is a time of auspiciousness. That this is a time, in the words of an Iranian poet, right? That what if the darkness we're experiencing is not the darkness of the tomb, but the darkness of the womb. So I think we are turning the corner. We are at a more creative point than we've probably ever been in recent memory, and that is the trajectory that will carry us forward.
You know, prophesizing is kind of a dangerous sport. I can see possible trajectories, and it's amazing what could happen, but there's, going back to your chaos theory, how we actually, I love the fact that it's women here, and we're talking about coherence, which was the exchange earlier. If we're bringing things to coherence, I think it's work. I think it's still putting our heads down and sincerely with our hearts, take a look at those people around us and touch and understand and listen. I keep saying listen, but it's also understanding, because we have different ways of thinking. We have different epistemologies completely, and we need to know what that means from one place to the other, and even one gender to another. And I think the trajectories are really about taking time.
Mahalo.
Okay, prophecy. So, before I left Aotearoa, I spoke about how I felt about contemporary art and how it was being practiced, and I used this idea of it's a question actually. Are we worshipping the ashes of culture, or are we keeping the fires burning? And so this was a question I keep asking myself also. And I suppose it comes down to not being afraid to dig deeper for self-understanding, and to be in relationship with people, not just at a superficial perfunctory level. It's not just about, okay, you know, Le'uli, what are you making? I want to make an exhibition. I'm not interested in that. I really want to know, how are you? And how is your family? And you know, what are the things that that concern you? Where you're from? And so it's this, you know, to echo Nugroho, the Indonesian artist who came here on residency, was one of the victims of the president's directive that people from particular Muslim countries had to leave, and I think you know how that fell out. But this artist who's in the exhibition was affected by this, and yet the night before he was deported, he had to leave, he created that artwork in the back, which asks for tolerance and simply states peace and love and care. And I, for one, was so compelled by this that it became the banner out the front entrance. Because I think we go so far away from who we are. We really need to come back to who we are. And it's in these very basic foundational values that we all share. It doesn't matter where you're from. And you know, I think this is my prophecy of, and it's still a question: are we worshiping the ashes, or are we maintaining the fires?
Ei huana una e piki ano lalo e hui ana nā moku e kū ana ka pai. I mua ka lāhui o hoka inui ākia. Mahalo, mahalo nui.
Sweet dreams, everybody. No question. Let's go home. Thank you for staying this late.